Good evening, everyone, and welcome. My name is Matt McKinnon, and I'm the Manager of Events for the Kitchener Public Library, and I am pleased to welcome you to tonight's event. Before we begin, I would like to start with a territorial acknowledgement. As we gather, we are reminded that the library is situated on land that is the traditional home of the Haudenosaunee, Anishinaabe, and Neutral people. We recognize and deeply appreciate their historic connection to this place. We also recognize the contributions Indigenous peoples have made in shaping and strengthening this community. We are grateful for the opportunity to meet here and reaffirm our collective commitment to make the promise and the challenge of truth and reconciliation real in our community. At this time, I would like to introduce our moderator for this evening, Mallory Andrews, followed by tonight's guest, Adam. Mallory Andrews is a film critic and programming curator from Toronto. She was formerly the managing editor of Clio, an online journal of film and feminism. Her work has also appeared in publications like Little White Lies, Esquire, The Dissolve, and CinemaScope. Mallory's first book, The Feminist Film Guide, 100 Great Films to See, that also passed the Bechdel test, comes out March 8th, 2022. Adam Nayman is a critic based in Toronto. He writes for The Ringer, is a contributing editor to CinemaScope, and has written several books on cinema, including The Coen Brothers, this book really ties the films together, and Paul Thomas Anderson, Masterworks. Mallory and Adam, welcome to the KPL.
Thank you so much, Matt. I'm so happy to be here tonight with my good friend and colleague, Adam Nayman. Adam and I have known each other for about maybe 10 years, it's been really a pleasure watching his career grow with each and every book, each one better than the last. And tonight we're talking about David Fincher, Mind Games, a handsome volume, as my brother would say. So I just wanted to kick off tonight. I know like your previous three books with Abrams, they're sort of, I mean, in my mind, consider them like an informal like trilogy simply because they're all with Abrams. They're all sort of beautiful looking. And they're all sort of about the filmography of a single director, but each one sort of, you made the interesting choice to sort of organize, talk about the movies in a different order than one might expect. The Coen book, it's in the order of release, which is sort of the usual way that that these filmmakers are talked about. The PTA book, you did it in the order of in which the films take place in history. And for this one, you went in a different direction. I'm just wondering if you could speak on that, the decision to go into that, to sort of group the movies thematically and what sort of went into choosing the order that you did.
No, I mean, it's funny. I never ever go on things like Goodreads or read Amazon reviews, but someone alerted me to a review on Goodreads where someone is like, what is with the baffling decision to group these movies thematically? It did not work for this guy. This guy was not, was not happy with that. But I thought that with Fincher, I wanted it to have the feeling sort of procedurally of almost kind of a case study, because that's one of the things that his movies often get across. And so once we sort of decided that aesthetically there would be something of a dossier design, that this idea of sort of pairing the movies at different junctures and at different points in his career, you know, pairing them around themes that add up together to a kind of psychological profile of an auteur filmmaker kind of made a lot of sense. And it let me put movies in conversation in some ways that are very obvious. I mean, of course, Seven and Zodiac and Mindhunter go together, but, you know, also to try and take some movies that superficially don't seem that similar, like Alien 3 or Panic Room or Social Network and Benjamin Button, and tease out those aspects that I think make them very, you know, conversant with each other. And it is a way, I think, I mean, you want it to have positive reasons to do it because it gets you somewhere. But beyond the where it gets you, it also gets you away from the strict, boring narrative chronology of a filmmaker's career. Because I think that that's really what happens in a lot of profiles and overviews and roundups. And there's nothing wrong with it. There's a coherence to it, and it's factually true that this is the order the movies come out in and how the career builds. But, you know, we don't have the full shape of the career. Writing on working filmmakers is a big risk because you never know when your book is going to land on a Phantom Thread as its last chapter, when your book is going to land on a Mank, right? So you try and find ways to make the movies seem as exciting and dynamic and synchronized as possible. So, you know, I think that the pairings make sense. And I think some of them to read, certainly to write, but also to read, I mean, I think are pretty fun. I think Dragon Tattoo and Gone Girl together is just very intuitive. And I got a lot out of those two movies talking about them, together. So some of it is just trying to not be conventional, and some of it is finding that there are reasons in those pairings that illuminate those movies, or I hope they do.
For sure. And and you do sort of end up talking about his last three movies chronologically as well. I have to imagine that was planned, because like everything that came before sort of feeds into the his last sort of 15 years of his career.
Well, Mank,
with the exception of Mindhunter, which sort of comes at the beginning, but you sort of make a case for that being a slightly different.
Yeah, I mean, and again, it's got to go somewhere, right? I mean, I'm going to guess you're not chomping at the bit to discuss Mank, but what I will say about Mank, and then if other Mank-related questions come up, we can pursue them, is...
I just watched Mank this weekend, so like we can talk about Mank if you want to talk about Mank.
I saw you just watch Mank because Letterboxd allows us to surveil friends and strangers alike. And I said, I wonder if she did that for this. But I mean, at a certain point when the book was being greenlit and put together, and it's really, really fast turnaround in a pandemic, which is also kind of fun to talk about. But we kind of knew that this book was going to come out not in time to be released really with Mank, but that was going to be the end point. You're not going to hold it for another 2 years until whatever movie he makes next. And, you know,
Mindhunter season 3.
Or Mindhunter season 3, which again, I would like us to get. But, you know, with the Coen brothers book, it did come out simultaneously with Scruggs, which is why Scruggs couldn't be in it. And with the Anderson book, it came out when I think maybe without the pandemic, Licorice Pizza might have originally come out. But you can't plan these things, especially when they're not literally in collaboration with the filmmakers. So I knew that Mank would be the last movie and kind of exist in a category in and of itself, because there's not going to be enough reception of it to satisfactorily pair it with any of the other movies. And in a lot of ways, I think it is an outlier and different, you know, within his filmography. But his Fincher's very, let's say, rough reception, maybe not from mainstream critics, but the rough reception that movie got in cinephile circles, the way that he seemed to bring that on himself by slagging Orson Welles and by really, really challenging, I thought in unproductive ways, you know, the popularity of Welles, I kind of knew that was going to be a good way to meet the question of his auteurism head on. I quote in the book a really great critic, exponentially greater than myself and a many times published author, Joseph McBride, who's a John Ford expert. And I thought McBride now has the line on David Fincher. I don't agree with it, but how can you top something like David Fincher is not fit to hold Orson Welles' viewfinder? Whether it's true or not, it's such a suggestive image. The viewfinder is suggestive because it indicates that what Fincher has is an eye and not much else. And the idea that he's not even fit to hold Welles, there's so much about history and authorship and creativity bound up in that. And I bless Joseph McBride for writing that, because as much as he hates Mank and as much as he doesn't respect Fincher, that was a fun jumping off point for the book. The second I read him write that, I said, this is the opening of the book. It's gotta be.
I interview you quote from Fincher in the book, talking about, you know, the Mank script, obviously written by his father. And I really appreciated his frankness in saying, you know, like, you know, we didn't quite crack it. And watching it for the first time this weekend, I just remember thinking, yeah, no kidding.
No kidding. Yeah, crack. He didn't quite crack it. Oh, sorry, go on.
Not just the script. There's just Oh, no, this is just going to be my awkward segue into talking about the next clip that I wanted everybody to show, just so we're not going to spend the evening just slagging on Mank. But it's not just like the script doesn't quite, they didn't quite crack the script, but also some of the choices made in terms of using technology to make it look like it's from the past. Some choices that were made to do that, and then the other choices made not to, like, you know, black and white, having the cigarette burn real changes, but maintaining like the totally anachronistic widescreen. But it's funny how that type of thing doesn't work here, but it does work in Zodiac, at least for me, which I would consider my favorite Fincher movie. I'm not sure about
you, Adam,
if we, yeah.
I think it's his best. And I think you're right about the use of technology to mimic the past, Zodiac being probably the first really big example of that for him, outside of his music video work, obviously. You know, where it's his first period piece, right? So that's where he starts doing that, using digital to evoke celluloid, and he's really trying to evoke the look of a period and also of a period's cinema. So the you know, leaping to Zodiac from where we were makes perfect sense, I think.
Sure. Shall we throw to the clip? And
yeah, one thing I want to say to set up the clip, if that's okay, we can talk about it after, but you know, this is from the opening of the film, and I tried to talk in my chapter about how there's all of these different kinds of pop cultural signifiers that he's playing with here. And he's juxtaposing, you know, like kind of documentary reality and truth and docudrama fact with this incredible pop cultural sort of symbolism and this incredible pop cultural poetry, which is I want to talk about after. I mean, it's so played out to talk about things like needle drops, but I remember the first time I saw this movie, the couple of uses of pop songs in this first 5 minutes, like my just jaw was on the floor, how intuitive and great they were. Never thought of Fincher as a needle drop filmmaker, really, but he's in the canon for these 5 minutes alone, I think.
So cruel to be hard, easy to become. How can people have no feeling? How can they ignore their friends?
Where have you been? I've been waiting since 7.
Get in, I have to find fireworks.
Let me drive.
Get in, I haven't eaten in 24 hours. Are you coming or not?
I thought you were starving.
Let's go someplace quiet.
Okay. What do we get?
Sitting, listening to music, talking.
You seem weird. Is everything okay?
Yeah, everything's fine. It's July. How many shirts are you wearing?
I'm cold.
You're cold on the 4th of July.
Fuck up and die!
What?
Fuck off and die?
Shut up.
Yeah.
because I carved the drive. I saw that card, Mr. Benz. Do you want me to tell him to leave?
Stay in the car.
Is that your husband?
No.
Who was that, darling?
Don't worry about it.
Don't tell me not to worry. Who was
it? It's nothing.
Let's go. Now, Dee. Get your wallet. Man, you really creeped us out.
Yeah, that movie haunts me every time I watch it.
Yeah.
In part, we want to get into the needle drops. I love the move that song had. Like, I don't notice the song drop. I don't notice the needle dropping because it sort of starts out on the radio, and when it moves into the soundtrack, that's the drop.
Yeah. Totally.
But beforehand, it's standing in for this very creepy, ominous presence. You make reference in the chapter on about evokes like this sort of Manson era unease and anxiety and paranoia.
Well, yeah, I mean, Donovan was sort of a Bob Dylan, clone. I mean, Dylan told him off if you watch Don't Look Back, but he's certainly writing that song in concert with, this kind of peace, love, summer of love, flower power vibe. But the song right from the beginning feels off. It's such a creepy song, it's singing songs of love, supposedly coming this sort of like this hurdy-gurdy man is supposed to be a musician and a peacemaker, but the arrangement is so creepy, and the way that Fincher picked up on that, he's sort of suggesting some dark side to the counterculture. But everything about the scene, so evocative of the era, the 4th of July fireworks, the strangely Norman Rockwell-ish vibe of the neighborhood and the kids, which is then undone when you learn things about them, like they're not teenagers, she's married, there's a suggestion of adultery. I mean, she's cheating, they don't want to be seen. Everything about it is not just unsettling, but it's of a piece with its moment right up until the moment it becomes Bonnie and Clyde, right? And, you know, yeah. And when it becomes Bonnie and Clyde, it's so stunning, because in Bonnie and Clyde, it's like the punishment of these outlaw characters, and the audience is made to feel complicit as a climax. And this, I mean, imagine starting where Bonnie and Clyde ends, with characters who we know nothing about, who've been chosen at random and aren't being punished for anything. It's such intuitively brilliant choices. And yet it also serves the docudrama reality that the movie is about. And it's one of the reasons I love Zodiac, because it's imaginative and inventive, but it makes those things out of real life and out of real material and out of the archive. And it was such a leap for Fincher, I think, when he did that, beyond what he had done before.
Yeah, and sort of a willingness to let the uncertainty of the real life story be what the movie is about, rather than sort of tying things up or combine. I mean, there's some facts that are obviously combined or characters that are composites, but just like, well, things like the having multiple people play Zodiac.
Yeah.
The voice, I don't remember, I don't think John Carroll Lynch, who is the sort of plays Arthur Lee Allen, who is sort of the main suspect for the identity of Zodiac. I don't think it's him doing the voice that we hear calling into the police station.
No, it's never.
Or is it in that instance? There's a couple of instances where it's his voice. There's a few instances. It's never him?
He is never physically the Zodiac in the movie. He's never the body of the Zodiac that we see. And so that idea of a movie that's made in these rigorous increments, but that's about uncertainty. I mean, we could go on about Zodiac forever talking about it that way, but it's such an ingenious idea that you make a movie that is based on textural and textual veracity. Everything looks as it was and is presented as it was. And it's all this certainty and all this recreation, but in the service of the idea that you are actually not going to know a thing about what happened. And, and certainty is not only impossible, certainty is almost, something to be mocked. It's a kind of cosmic joke. And he'd never made something that had that cosmic scope before. And I can't say that the first time I saw Zodiac, that all struck me, the sheer size of and kind of metaphysical heft of what he was working with. But like you, the movie haunts me, and I like being haunted by it. It's weirdly a comfort watch for me. I find the uncomfortableness of it comforting. I'm not like getting off on the violence, because it's actually not that violent a movie. After the first 30 minutes, violence disappears.
Yeah, which is sort of interesting considering, you obviously pair them with his other sort of serial killer movies, where in Seven, that's kind of it's almost Hannibal-like, and it's like, look at these sort of tableaus of murder and death, whereas this is like very much the opposite of that. In fact, we're like it's leaning into not the horror of it for aesthetic's sake, the horror of it for like, this is a horrific thing that happened.
Well, this is a horrific thing that happened, and it rebuts. I mean, it doesn't. It's kind of an apology for Seven, just in the idea that, you know, in Seven it had this very seductive idea of a guru-like serial killer, but it's very similar to Seven in that it's about a killer who's trying to get an idea out into the world and kind of communicate through these crime scenes. It's just that in Seven, what he's communicating is very lucid because it's a fictional screenplay. And Zodiac suggests that he wasn't really communicating anything lucid. He's just an awful, crazy, unpleasant figure, but it still caught on and took root within the culture. And as a movie about something that prompted culture-wide obsession and kind of opened the Pandora's box of true crime and everything else, I think it's an amazing reckoning and accounting with Fincher's own interests. And it's not a surprise that he said in many interviews, you know, he grew up in California adjacent to the Zodiac. And so when he was a little kid, that's what everyone was scared of. You can see on some level, there's a personal stake and investment in this terror that is maybe not present in some of his other work in the same way.
Yeah, totally. I want to switch gears a little bit, but yeah. I mean, it's all connected. I'd like to talk about, I mean, speaking of something that somebody would have seen younger and sort of been enraptured by it, for a lot of folks of at least my generation coming up in film school, a lot of people have cited Fight Club as their sort of entry point into wanting to learn about film, explore film more, for better, for worse, whatever your opinion of that movie is. And it's kind of funny, like I would consider Fight Club and The Matrix sort of coming out around the same time, activating people politically, again, for better or for worse, the IKEA. So within the scene, it's like the scene with in the apartment with the IKEA overlay of Ed Norton's apartment.
Sure, let's show the clip, and then it's definitely a fun one to talk about.
For 6 months, I couldn't sleep. I couldn't sleep. I couldn't sleep. With insomnia, nothing's real. Everything's far away. Everything's a copy of a copy of a copy. When deep space exploration ramps up, it'll be the corporations that name everything. The IBM Stellar Sphere, the Microsoft Galaxy, Planet Starbucks.
Gonna need you out of town a little more this week. We've got some red flags to cover.
It must have been Tuesday. He was wearing his cornflower blue tie.
You want me to deprioritize my current reports until you advise of a status upgrade?
Make these your primary action items. Here's your flight coupons. Call me from the road if there's any snags.
He was full of pep. Must have had his grande latte enema. Like so many others, I had become a slave to the IKEA nesting instinct.
Yes. I'd like to order the Erica Picari dust ruffles. Please hold.
If I saw something clever, like a little coffee table in the shape of a yin-yang, I had to have it. The Klipsk personal office unit, the Hovatrack home exerbike, or the Ohanishov sofa with the string green stripe pattern. Even the Rizlampa wire lamps of environmentally friendly unbleached paper. I'd flip through catalogs and wonder, what kind of dining set defines me as a person? I had it all. Even the glass dishes with tiny bubbles and imperfections, proof that they were crafted by the honest, simple, hardworking indigenous peoples of wherever.
I was holding.
We used to read pornography. Now it was the Horchow collection.
No, you can't die from insomnia.
What about narcolepsy? I nod off, I wake up in strange places, I have no idea how I got there.
You need to lighten up.
Can you please just give me something?
Red and blue two-in-alls, lipstick red second-alls.
No. You need healthy, natural sleep. Chew some valerian root and get more exercise.
It's been a long time since I had revisited Fight Club, and this time around, it was striking to me, like the IKEA overlay reminds me of Instagram, where you can sort of, you know, like interior design influencer tagging everything, where they've bought everything in their apartment.
Yeah, that idea of tagging and walking through. I mean, when you mentioned Zodiac as a point of entry, Fight Club as a point of entry, I mean, I was 18 when it came out, and it was extremely important to me to not like this movie. And I've held on to not liking it for a long time, and it's still not one I would ever consider my favorite, though in writing about it and taking it apart, I have a tremendous appreciation for it. For one thing, just how put together it is. You can learn so much about lens length just in that 2 minutes that we watched, and about composition and blocking. And again, that incredible lo-fi effect, which was all shot with real three-dimensional materials filling in the apartment, almost using stop motion illusionism. It's not a digital effect if you read about it. But also the two things, I mean, one, he used the exact same effect in Zodiac when the Zodiac is scrawled three-dimensionally all over the city. It's amazing how similar the moment in Zodiac is to Fight Club, the idea of characters trapped in a kind of text overlay world. But also, you know, that sequence is really cards on the table for Fincher in 1999 because of his advertising background. And because of the extent to which in advertising and music videos, he has been a kind of blank conveyor of corporate interest. You know, his commercials and music videos aren't just technically accomplished. They did a brilliant job selling whatever artists they were selling. There's artistry in them, but they're more artisanal, right? you know, that idea that he referred to the production company he made, Propaganda. He said, we're like a jukebox. You put your money in one end and your video comes out the other. And the material of Palahniuk's novel, among other things, I think gave him a really fascinating opportunity to reckon with and exercise and interrogate the ad man part of himself. I mean, this is a guy with a big chip on his shoulder, right up to and including Mank. Mank is a movie made by someone who's hugely ambivalent about Hollywood apparatus. And I think his Rosebud, to stick with the Mank analogy, is when he was told on the set of Alien 3, you know, you're a shoe salesman. And that's why in Fight Club, those incredible two camera ad pitches by Pitt, they are advertising pitches and they use the same visual vocabulary as his Reebok ads or as his beer ads. He's just trying in a way to invert and play with that aesthetic and play with those ideas. You know, how subversive can a $60 million studio movie be? I think Fight Club offers an interesting answer to that question, which is simultaneously pretty subversive and also not subversive at all. And I think if you allow yourself to accept that ambivalence, it's such a fascinating movie. And also, again, not to get too like cranky and reactionary and old manish, but like people can't make movies like this anymore. The craft of it is beyond the crop of contemporary early to mid-career American filmmakers. They can't do what he did. I don't even like the movie that much, but the way it's made.
No, because it's. Yeah, like the I'm glad you brought up Alien 3, because I was gonna mention that, like, you really feel how haunted he was by that experience in every chapter in this book.
Oh, totally.
Clearly.
Yeah.
But it's also like the idea that you couldn't make a movie like this today. It's not just, you know, from the subject matter, but the idea of a director getting that much money to make a movie would only today be in service of a franchise, which is funny because Fincher, like before, it was like you have a sort of up and coming director. Let's hand him a franchise and see how he does. Whereas now it's sort of the opposite trajectory in terms of like what's considered, you know, Hollywood success.
Well, and I argue that he couldn't have gotten luckier with Dragon Tattoo insofar as they never made sequels.
Because
at a certain point, the material of those novels is so bad that he's not going to be able to do what he did with the first movie, which is, you know, elevate it to a kind of base level of interest. The way that the ending of the first Dragon Tattoo ends up being the end is incredibly fortunate. It would be ruined by a sequel because that lack of closure or lack of resolution and that heartbreak that he somehow manages along with Rooney Mara to pull out of that stupid book, you know, as soon as a sequel comes, they're going to be back together and the other stupid plot stuff is going to happen. So him dodging a franchise with the Dragon Tattoo is really good luck, you know?
Totally. And I don't even think he would have been that lucky even if he made it a few years later.
No, I don't think he would have been that. No, I don't think he would have been that lucky either, among other things, mm-hmm. by not being contractually obligated to plod through Girl with the Whatever. You know, he gets to do the superior paperback adaptation, which is Gone Girl, which is a movie that takes a lot of what I think is good and in some places formally brilliant in Dragon Tattoo, which is as well made as a movie can humanly be. The Girl with the Dragon Tattoo on a level of craft is, again, just stunning. But in Gone Girl, it's in the service of actually kind of interesting material. So instead of having to fight the material to a draw, he gets to I think, hit the material out of the park in Gone Girl, which is the mix there of form and content and even his own background in advertising. It's just killer.
Completely. And Gone Girl is also a really great summation of his casting director's talent at choosing the exact right person.
Totally.
For the role. And I find this Gone Girl an interesting one to talk about in the context of what's happening with Ben Affleck these days.
Yeah, well, early Affleck renaissance, right?
Yeah, the sort of, you know, he's the perfect material for a PR machine. He didn't have a great one when he was with Ana de Armas, but now he's got like a world-class PR machine working for him, just being on the arm of J-Lo.
Well, I quote a really great critic who I managed to do a podcast with about Fincher a couple months ago, Kent Jones, who used to run the New York Film Festival, and who I think is the great Fincher critic because he turned around on him. you know, if you reread Kent in the late 90s, for him, Fincher represented everything wrong with American cinema. And then after Zodiac, he sees him change. And while that's maybe not exactly how I feel, it's a plausible read, right? And when he wrote about Gone Girl in Film Comment, he got it so right. He said that this is a movie set in a world and made for a world where people are incrementally checking their self-projection at all times. And he's not saying the cliche thing. He's not saying it's a movie about Instagram or a movie about the internet. I mean, in some ways, Gone Girl, the novel, predates Instagram. And the movie's social media landscape is pretty primitive compared even to now. I mean, for a movie in 2014, it's relatively minor. But as a movie about people making minor adjustments and who are desperate for people to be aware of those adjustments, and then to have the thesis that this is how we act, not just in the social sphere, in the sphere of publicity, but how we act when we're just with other people in any situation. It's such a perfect Fincher movie, because everyone who says that he's cold and everyone who says that he's misanthropic, you know, you can have that. But what you can't have, and what I think works against that, is he's so interested in behavior. He's so interested in behavior. He's so interested in posture. He's so interested in self-presentation and the ways that people make their thoughts and feelings and desires visible or invisible. And boy, does that work well with the material in Gone Girl, and with the performance he gets out of Affleck, who mm-hmm. gives the performance of someone who, you know, both hates and is not terribly good at being scrutinized. And that's why it's so witty.
Yeah, it's... People don't think of Gone Girl as a comedy. Like, I think of Gone Girl as a comedy as much as like Phantom Thread is a comedy, where its genre is not necessarily comedy, but it's sort of working in that mode that I think, I remember seeing it with an audience who wasn't sure when to laugh or if they should be laughing, especially at some of Affleck's antics. Like, it was like, they couldn't tell, is he being a bad actor, or is his character not good at, like, just doesn't like being scrutinized, you know, is like so sick of being picked apart by fucking women or whatever is.
Yeah, a line that only Gillian Flynn can get away with because she writes the script. I mean, Gone Girl and Phantom Thread, functionally in their creator's career, are the same movies. Filmmakers who have been accused, not wrongly, of being mediocre gender politicians, making these romantic comedies that are fundamentally actually about the female character and in different ways enter into her subjectivity. I think the clip we have lined up for Gone Girl is a great example of how the material obliges Fincher to finally do something really from a female point of view for the first time, because it's as inside someone's head as Fight Club was, right?
Yeah.
I mean, that's another duality between Fight Club and Gone Girl, is the idea of interiority and seeing the world through a certain character's perspective. But in the clip we have, you know, coming from Gone Girl, the ideas are carried by Flynn's prose. I mean, he didn't ask her to rewrite anything. The cool girl monologue and all the social critique, and also for the character self-loathing, that's faithful to the book. But for those of us watching the clip, whether you've seen Gone Girl before or forget it, one idea I just want to get across, God, it's not me getting across, it's the film getting it across. I'm just trying to notice it. How he yokes speed to clarity. Because speed shouldn't be clear. Speed should be confusing. Speed should be disorienting. We think of things going too fast. You're going too fast. The speed here is the clarity. And this is why when I'm thinking about editing, and when I was talking in the book to his editor, Angus Wall, you know, I felt like the Chris Farley Show, you know, talking to the editor of Gone Girl and stuff, and being like, remember when you did that? How did you do that? How does he do that? How can something that is made up of half second shots have every single one of those shots register in terms of the text that you are looking at, or the sight gag that you
are... Is it like 26, 30 something inserts?
Yeah, it's astonishing. And yeah. it's the part of his film, and one of many components of his filmmaking I talk in the book, because some of it has to do with camera placement, and some of it is blocking, and some of it is the way he directs actors. But this is the sort of stuff that is, it's genuinely wizardly. And you can, and when someone tries to knock it off or imitate it in the same way that Gone Girl recognizes the difference between real and off-brand, you can tell off-brand Fincher within half a second.
So, yeah.
You can tell the off-brand Fincher in half a second. And when he's on brand, like he is in this scene that we're about to watch, I just think the the craft of it is stunning, quite apart even from the ideas. So we should watch it, because this
Let's take a look.
This scene is so fun.
Nick and Amy will be gone, but then we never really existed. Nick loved a girl I was pretending to be. Cool girl. Men always use that, don't they, as their defining compliment. She's a cool girl. Cool girl is hot. Cool girl is gay. Cool girl is fun. Cool girl never gets angry at her man. She only smiles in a chagrin, loving manner, and then presents her mouth for fucking. She likes what he likes. So evidently, he's a vinyl hipster who loves fetish manga. If he likes girls gone wild, she's a mall babe who talks football and endures buffalo wings at Hooters. When I met Nick Dunn, I knew he wanted cool girl. And for him, I'll admit, I was willing to try. I wax-stripped my pussy raw. I drank canned beer watching Adam Sandler movies. I ate cold pizza and remained a size 2. I blew him, semi-regularly. I lived in the moment. I was fucking game. I can't say I didn't enjoy some of it. Nick teased out in me things I didn't know existed. A lightness, a humor, an ease. But I made him smarter, sharper. I inspired him to rise to my level. I forged the man of my dreams. We were happy pretending to be other people. We were the happiest couple we knew. And what's the point of being together if you're not the happiest? But Nick got lazy. He became someone I did not agree to marry. He actually expected me to love him unconditionally. Then he dragged me, penniless, to the navel of this great country and found himself a newer, younger, bouncier, cool girl. You think I'd let him destroy me and end up happier than ever? No fucking way. He doesn't get to win. My cute, charming, salt-of-the-earth Missouri guy. He needed to learn. Grown-ups work for things. Grown-ups pay. Grown-ups suffer consequences.
So talking about speed, I believe there's a half-second shot in there where she's at the big supermarket and she's buying sheets marked Rampage.
Yeah, which is a detail I'd never noticed until I read it in the book. And this time watching the clip is like, oh yeah, it's like right there, but it's like it happens so fast. Because you're processing what you're seeing, but you're also processing her monologue, which is sort of in contrast to the things that she's saying. It's because it's not just speed of like it's speed of comprehension as well as like the speed of the images. You know, she's saying, you know, I meticulously maintained a size 2, and she's throwing junk food into her cart and, you know, buying reading glasses. And
well, and I hope that for the people who are watching, and again, you mentioned the pairing of the films in the book. I mean, Gone Girl and Fight Club aren't a pairing, and neither are Fight Club and Zodiac, but you can see, you know, I mentioned that the formal similarity between the text scribbles in Zodiac and the IKEA catalog, but that scene in Fight Club and that scene in Gone Girl, they fold over each other. I mean, they're the same sequence, essentially. They're not saying the same thing narratively, but that idea of walking into a completely branded, consumer-driven, kind of commodified world and becoming a sort of slave to ideas of perception or ideas of performance and gender performance. His interests remain consistent, and I think his mode of expression grows increasingly kind of virtuosic. And I think that Gone Girl is a film that can really be undersold, because you can say the material is trashy, or you can say that the narrative is implausible, and there's a lot of people who sort of find it smug. But I think it's not only aware of all those things, I think it subsumes them into this artificiality that I just think is so sophisticated and pleasurable, and which I feel the filmmaker is in control of, you know, and control isn't the only thing a filmmaker can do that's interesting. And maybe sometimes control is overrated, but I think that trash is not a problem for Fincher. I think it's his sweet spot. I think it's when he orbits more towards prestige, sometimes he actually loses his intelligence or his focus. But when he's in material like this, this is his...
It's his, like, the sweet spot.
It's his sweet spot. It's fish and water, I think, with him.
Totally. So I want to make sure we have time to throw to some questions. We have a couple in the questions here. I guess, first of all, like, what made you want to write about David Fincher of all directors? Or was that, you know, was that your choice?
Well, you know, the joke we have with those first three books is filmmakers I'm interested in / that people would pay $50 for a book on. And it's, you know, I'll be honest. I haven't said this, I don't think, really, to anybody. I mean, Fincher, I wanted to do more than I wanted to do Anderson, to be honest. Not a question of preferring him, because I don't. But I thought writing about the way that he directs and the formal potential of a book on him, I thought, was greater. I think Anderson came first because that was just the timing. And I think there's a warmth towards Paul Thomas Anderson, a kind of cinephile warmth that maybe more people would want to buy a book on him. Whereas with Fincher, it's, I think some people experience those movies casually. He's a super famous director on some level, but there's a lot of people who watch Seven and Social Network and don't care who made them. You know.
Completely. I mean, I remember, like, the VHS of Seven getting passed around when I was 13 as like a naughty thing to, like, watch that somebody's older sibling shared, but, like, not really in the context of, like, a great auteur.
Yeah, I mean, so he makes big commercial work, and so maybe there's a more casual fan base, and also a hyper obsessive fan base because he's such a gearhead and such a tech-driven director. No, I mean, I wanted to write the book about him because I think it's a body of work worth wrestling with. And one of my guiding principles as a critic is I'm just interested in stuff whether or not I think it's all that good. Which doesn't mean I think Fincher's movies are bad. That's certainly not the case that I'm making in the book. But I like that they have flaws, or I like that there are things I'm not convinced by. I liked trying to make the auteurist argument for someone who doesn't write their own films, and I'd like trying to make... you know, trying to describe different meanings of authorship and auteurism moving forward, because what it used to mean and what it's come to mean now are two very different things. In a way, Fincher's much more of a classical auteur than the singer-songwriter version of filmmaking, more than an Anderson or a Baumbach or a Sofia Coppola, because he doesn't write his own scripts. That was the original condition of perceiving this stuff.
Yeah.
So I think that that's an important thing to try and study, and I tried to.
Yeah, totally. Ooh, here's a good question that I think you, Adam, personally will have something interesting to say about. This is from Kevin. A few weeks ago, I saw an article that recommended films related to Zodiac, and one was Spore Loss, which I've seen you've written on very positively. He says he hasn't seen it himself, but can you speak on the connection and maybe recommend some of your other personal favorite older films that connect to Zodiac Gone Girl kind of feel?
Well, I did a lecture on Spore Loss last year for an online university. I wish it was recorded because it went well. But with Spore Loss, and I think Mallory might remember this, not that it's memorable, but it was wild when it happened. I made this random tweet where I was like, I'm thinking about movies that are evil, and, you know, maybe The Vanishing is evil. And I got like literally like 80,000 tweets worth of engagement. A lot of it was down insane rabbit holes where it got down to, like, you know, all, you know, just imagine, you know, political polarization and what people want to say is
picking apart, like, the difference between a depiction of evil and a film that is actively evil or whatnot.
But what I meant about The Vanishing, or about the Dutch version of Spore Loss, is that it is a movie that puts something out that has stayed with me and has not been a good thing in my life. The movie is incredibly great, but it, like, sits on my shoulder and won't leave because it's very upsetting. And what it's about is very upsetting, and how it expresses that is very upsetting. And the fact that it does so without being expressly violent is upsetting. And that's maybe one way I would link it to Zodiac, which is that it's a film of tremendous restraint. It's actually an interestingly Fincherian movie in terms of how much it's about procedure and protocol. I mean, I don't want to spoil it, but it really is. It's almost like watching a version of Seven where
procedure and even point of view and interiority.
Point of view, interior, but it's like if Seven was made from the point of view of someone with John Doe while he's, like, doing his crime scenes, that's kind of the way Vanishing is told, or half of it, because there's no mystery of who the bad guy is. You're introduced to him in like the first 10 minutes. And there's not even really a huge mystery around what he's done. It's just more the specifics of it. But no, I mean, anyone who's watching, if they haven't seen it, I would recommend it as highly as I can recommend something that also bothers me and makes me unhappy to think about and contemplate. I mean, maybe I wouldn't call it an evil movie, but I think it is a profoundly perceptive movie about very scary things, particularly that idea of, you know, what do we walk around with and repress? And if someone wants to see another movie that works that way, that I think is also interestingly conversant with Fincher. If anyone's seen Kiyoshi Kurosawa's Cure, that's another one of the scariest movies I've ever seen. And that I think would go on a really interesting millennial serial killer double bill with Seven. If you were to watch Cure and Seven back to back, I think you'd see really, really interesting approaches to very similar ideas by two master filmmakers. And I know Kiyoshi Kurosawa is a big David Fincher fan.
Yeah. So Adam, I know you you teach at U of T, so you have some insight into Gen Z.
Into Gen Z.
Yeah. Do you have you experienced any of Gen Z's response to David Fincher, or like sort of what he means to, like, I'm talking from the perspective of a millennial, and like I know what my peers think, and I've talked a little bit about it tonight, right? But like, what's his legacy for the next generation?
I don't know. I just looked at the attendance list, and I see at least one student from the authorship class I was in, and asked them what they think of Fincher. I mean, Gen Z. I think that he's a filmmaker who I think is always going to mean a little more to Gen X, to people who were there. You know, I think that we didn't even get into it, and that's okay. But I mean, you know, the impact of the music video work and the role that he played in consolidating, you know, Madonna's image and George Michael's image on MTV and Don Henley. I mean, that's such a big part of who he is. I think that probably the movie he's made in the last 10 or 15 years that let's say Gen Z or people in their early 20s probably will have the strongest relationship to is Social Network, because it's so, I don't know, he once said he wanted it to be like The Breakfast Club meets Citizen Kane, which is funny. And while I wouldn't compare it to Citizen Kane, especially not in light of the whole Wellesian, you know, controversy, it is a kind of Gen Z Citizen Kane, right? It's about industry and ambition and looking at this asshole through the eyes of his friends and whatever else. But he's not a super, I don't think he's a super beloved filmmaker among really, really young cinephiles. But I think for people in their 40s, he's in their 30s and 40s, like my friends are, like, you know, we are. You're not as old as I am. I'm very old. You're not. But for people in a certain age group, you know, he's right there. Maybe I'll get a chance to teach him at some point. I know.
Yeah,
Sorry. What are you going
to
say?
I was just going to say, to paraphrase Lena Dunham, maybe not the voice of a generation, but a voice of a generation.
I mean, I do know at U of T that in the authorship course, Bart Test has taught him before, and he's told me that he's found the students have found Fincher, to circle right back to the first phrase we used, you know, a bit of a tough nut to crack. Not because the movies are hard, the movies are very easy to watch, but then trying to figure out what is the relationship between this technical proficiency and the kind of raggedness or contradiction you kind of expect from art? You know, I sort of tried to talk about that in the book a little bit, that with Fincher, there's a lot of people where instead of a signature, what they see is a barcode, you know, where they see a kind of catalog number. And I can't really go with that. I can't imagine actually thinking that myself watching these movies, but I try and imagine why people do. And there's a certain tradition of cinephilia that I think he's really threatening towards, especially something like Mank, which comes in and plays so irresponsibly with not just the visual history that you're talking about, because it doesn't look at all like a movie of the 40s, nothing like a movie of the 1940s. But it's also just like factually and politically and ideologically inaccurate, in the same way that people look at something like JFK or Forrest Gump and are like, this movie is dangerous. mean, you know, there's a way of looking at Mank that I think it can seem like a little bit of a threat to the real history of the studio system and Wells and whatever else.
Yeah. We have time for one more quick question. Yeah, sure. I mean, we'll determine if it's quick or not.
We're on the internet. No one's going anywhere.
True. Are there filmmakers who have popped up post 2000? So it would be like the post Fight Club era, whose work reminds you of Fincher?
Whose work reminds you? I mean,
yeah.
You know,
for better or for worse. I mean, you know, good or bad.
It's a good question. I mean, there's the off-brand Finchers, you know, anybody who kind of just color grades the stuff down and edits quickly. I mean, the answer I want to give is a kind of cheeky answer, which is the most Fincherian movie I've seen in years, and actually the best David Fincher movie of 2020 is not Mank, but The Empty Man by David Pryor, who's not technically David Fincher, but he's shot all of Fincher's behind-the-scenes stuff for a long time. And Empty Man is a movie that has the speed and convergence and smoothness that I associate with great Fincher. It's a better movie than Mank is, maybe not as substantial because Mank is a movie of ideas, but I've watched The Empty Man like 10, you know, six times. I'm not going to watch Mank six times ever again in my life. But I think that this is the thing, oft imitated, but rarely duplicated. I mean, I'm a big fan, almost to a point of self-parody on Twitter, of a Catalan filmmaker named Jaume Collet Serra, who is a genre specialist, and his style's not really like Fincher, but I like thinking of him as someone who, you know, works really evocatively and expressively in genre structures. Like, I love Orphan and I like The Shallows, but you know, this was a tough year to be a fan of his because he went and made Jungle Cruise. And even though Jungle Cruise, the Disney movie with The Rock, it's actually not even that awful. He says embarrassedly that I've seen it. You know, I don't think it's that bad.
I have kids, it's fine.
But, you know, it's sad to see that that's the reward. The reward for being a kind of strapping middleweight genre filmmaker is that you get to do that, you know? So, but I don't know. I mean, I got pretty lucky in this book, who I got to write the introduction, who is technically a post-Fincher filmmaker. I don't think anyone would describe him as an imitator, but there's such a connection between Bong Joon-ho and Fincher, which is why he had no reason to agree to write the intro. I think his producer said he agreed to write the intro because he agreed with the request, is what Doo-Hoo Choi, his producer, said. Is he said Bong appreciates the he appreciates being asked because he gets why you would want him to write about David Fincher, which I thought was a really funny email, because I think there's something that those guys share in terms of clarity and speed and the idea that you can use genre in a really socially kind of cutting way, as just the most flattering thing in the world that he went for. I like that they're now linked through him writing that intro. And I joked, I hope that someone who writes a book on Bong Joon-ho asks David Fincher to write the intro. I'd love to see the answer to that.
That would be your next book, perhaps?
No, I think someone, without putting too fine a point on it, I know someone else is hopefully writing a book soon on Bong, and it's someone who will do a better job than I would. I love that we reproduced Bong's intro in the book in Korean characters as well.
I loved that. I love that too. I think we're about at time, so that's a good note to go out on. Bong's always a great note to go out on.
Absolutely. And you know, thank you to the library and to you for the conversation. I'm just sorry that the Cool Girl monologue didn't load for me, because it's just fun to watch. I could hear it but not see it, so maybe I'll just go watch it at home now.
All right, Adam, Mallory, thank you so much for joining us tonight. I feel we've only like scratched the surface with Fincher right now. How these things usually go with you, Adam. You have a lot to say, a lot of good stuff to say, and it's hard to convey it in a hour-long chat. But that's what the book is for. So and the thing that strikes me about the book, Adam, is what when we first talked about it, and you mentioned it tonight, is how, you know, the Coen Brothers book and the Paul Thomas Anderson book, they sort of have built-in ardent fan bases, where the Fincher does not. And even though, like, I think your book makes a very strong case for him as a, you know, beyond his craftsmanship, which is sort of his calling card, and just how he's such a good formalist in that. But you just make a very strong case for him as a very solid filmmaker, like he needed it, but I think it's there. And what else was I gonna say? But
very, 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 very kind of you to say. I appreciate it.
Yeah, no, and yeah, and I encourage everyone to check out the book. Adam's a great writer, very articulate, and yeah, we always love to have you here, Adam, and hopefully next time in person as it goes. And again, thank you all for joining us tonight. Have a great rest of the week, and we hope to see you soon.
Thank you. Thanks again, Mallory. It was so fun.
Bye-bye. Oh, it was a pleasure. Always a pleasure.
Bye.